Mission Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Listen Well, Lead Better, Becoming the Leader People Want to Follow, by Steve Harling and Becky Harling. Narrated by William Sarris. 1. The Missing Ingredient to Greater Influence. Tune your ears to wisdom and concentrate on understanding. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 2. New Living Translation. Key: the secret sauce to your leadership is your ability to listen. Many leaders are missing one of the most essential ingredients to greater influence. They might be great visionaries, super implementers, and profound orators. But if they don't listen well, they're leading beneath their potential. I, Steve, know this all too well. I became a pastor right out of college, leading a little turn-of-the-century church in a farming community. The church building wasn't impressive, but we had good people. I loved that church and was loved by the people. I was eager to lead it well. I went to every pastor's conference I could afford. I learned the guiding principles of church growth. I started to get noticed, and doors were opened over the ensuing years to lead other larger churches. Eventually, I was invited to become the lead pastor of a megachurch with scores of staff and hundreds of ministries. Within weeks of my new appointment, I'd articulated a big vision featuring a $30 million expansion plan to accommodate 7,000 worshipers every weekend. Brimming with confidence and passionate about my vision, I didn't have time to waste. I figured that everyone would fall in line behind my leadership, like rookies at basic training. Didn't happen. While the early adopters were with me, the rest of the leadership was left in the dust, including the chairman of the elder board. He and I lived on different planets. Our ideas about worship, teaching, and leadership were light years apart. I was a visionary flying at 40,000 feet. I considered him an analytical bean counter lost in the weeds. I didn't understand him. I didn't understand the people who supported him. I'm sad to say that I didn't care to understand them. I was called by God. As far as I was concerned, they needed to line up behind the vision of God's anointed, me. They didn't. Our private feud went public. It was outwit, outlast, outplay. I became more entrenched in my views. They became more entrenched in theirs. 2 years into our titanic battle for control of the church, the board of elders had had enough. Both of us were put out to pasture. Looking back, I wish I'd handled things differently. If I'd listened, I could have diffused the conflict. If I'd listened, I could have established trust with the congregation. If I'd listened, I could have built ownership around the vision. Sometimes our greatest mistakes become our greatest learnings. I am blessed today to run Reach Beyond, a global missions agency with staff and partners scattered around the world. When I first stepped in as the CEO, Becky and I made the strategic decision that we would lead by listening. In our first year, we visited every part of the world where our people serve. We asked lots of questions and did a lot of listening. Those meetings were invaluable. They helped us get branded and bonded to the organization, and they provided us with the relational insight that we needed to chart a new course. All those trips and meetings also made something else very clear to us. We can't possibly anticipate every situation and detail. To lead to our fullest potential, we had to fine-tune our listening skills and develop some new habits. Like Steve, I, Becky, have had some hard-earned leadership lessons through the years. At one church, I felt confident about my vision for our small groups ministry. We had assembled an implementation team, but my ideas were getting pushback from one particular member of the team. I would walk away from meetings thinking, "I want to quit. I'm not doing a good job. She doesn't see my vision. I need to communicate it more clearly." In my mind, I wasn't being compelling enough, so I would gather more information and prepare my arguments for the next meeting. The problem with that? I had forgotten a well-accepted observation. 80% of good communication involves listening. Finally, I sought some advice from a friend on the team, someone who was an executive in a large company. She listened attentively as I expressed my frustration until I finally asked, "How am I coming across?" I'll never forget her response. She first shared her view that my so-called adversary was an external processor. What I saw as combative was merely a person trying to figure out her feelings by processing out loud. Finally, my friend said, "When she processes and you get tense, you talk more instead of listening and drawing her out. As a result, you come off a bit insecure and defensive." Ouch. My friend was exactly right. I have to admit that I was insecure in my leadership in those days. Whenever I felt insecure, I shut down and withdrew, became defensive, or came on too strong to prove my point. God began to whisper in my ear that He had plans to use me as a leader, but that in order for Him to use me, I needed to learn to listen. I wanted others to follow, but I didn't understand that in order for them to feel motivated to follow, they needed to feel heard. About 15 years ago, I got serious about my listening skills and began intentionally working on them. I became certified through the John Maxwell team as a leadership coach. I learned how important it is to listen attentively, to ask great questions, and to offer others value by being fully present. As my listening skills grew, so did my influence. The expanse of your leadership platform is directly linked to how well you listen. No one wants to follow someone who won't listen to others. The truth is, many leaders have lost their credibility because they haven't put any effort into their listening skills. Once credibility is lost, it's mighty hard to regain. The key to building loyal, empowered, and engaged teams is to listen attentively. Ask yourself, what about you? You're a leader, or you want to be a leader. That's what compelled you to pick up this book. Leadership is influence. If you don't listen, you give up your influence. Take a few moments to ask yourself a few questions. What kind of listener are you? Would your colleagues describe you as a good listener? Does your team feel heard and valued by you? Why is it so important anyway? Aren't leaders supposed to tell others what to do? Yes, leaders are supposed to give direction. But if they don't first listen and the thoughts and concerns of others are ignored, disaster will often follow. We need only to look back in history to see that this is true. In 1912, the Titanic sank. Many historians now believe that the root cause of the tragedy was that leadership didn't listen. According to an article in Entrepreneur magazine, investigations revealed that key engineers tried to discuss the limited safety capacity with senior-level management. However, their efforts fell on deaf ears. The result of leaders not listening was catastrophic. According to a Gallup poll, only 1/3 of Americans are fully engaged in their work. When Gallup explored this further, the leading cause for disengagement in the workplace is lack of effective communication. Leaders aren't listening. On the other hand, managers who held regular team meetings and listened to their teams had a much more vested team. Gallup also found that engagement was highest among employees who had some form, face-to-face, phone, or digital, of daily communication with their managers. Managers who used a combination of face-to-face, phone, and electronic communication are the most successful and engaging employees. Those who respond to calls and messages within 24 hours make their staff members feel heard and valued. We're guessing what you're thinking. I'm so overwhelmed, I can't return all those emails within 24 hours. Or, I can't have that many face-to-face meetings with everyone on my team. Impossible. We get it. To be truthful, we both fail at this from time to time. We try, but because of delayed flights, lack of sleep, volume of emails, or plenty of other excuses, we often blow it. So we're ready to offer you grace if you'll offer grace to us. But the point is, people need to feel heard and valued if they're going to stay engaged and productive. It's up to us as leaders to figure out how best to deliver that. Texts, phone calls, emails, or face-to-face. Figuring that out demonstrates that you're willing to lead by listening. What if you asked your team, "How would you like me to communicate with you? Is text, email, or video conferencing best for you to feel heard and connected with me?" Can you imagine how the tone would change when you ask them how they would like to feel heard by you? Game changer. The research is clear. If you don't listen, and listen well, you'll probably sabotage your leadership and you might wind up sinking your nonprofit, church, or company. If you are a person of faith, there's even more at stake here than just your leadership. What's faith got to do with it? Listening is important to God. The Old Testament book of Proverbs alone has at least 22 verses that either extol the value of listening or teach some concept of listening. In the New Testament, the call to listen well is often repeated. Consider carefully how you listen, Luke chapter 8, verse 18. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, James chapter 1, verse 19. Jesus modeled listening leadership with the woman at the well, John chapter 4, verses 1 through 26, the blind man by Jericho, Mark chapter 10, verse 51, and the religious leader Nicodemus, John chapter 3, verses 1 through 21, to name just a few. It was important to Jesus to hear the hearts of those he served and draw out their thoughts and concerns. He didn't just preach great sermons and do awesome miracles. Jesus listened, asked great questions, and offered his full presence. He didn't lord it over people or treat them as somehow lesser than himself. Instead, he listened to their stories, invited them to join him, and served them with a humble ear. He invites those of us who lead others to follow his example of listening. He said, "For those who are not listening, even what they think they understand will be taken away from them." Luke chapter 8, verse 18. Pretty strong words. Unfortunately, while many of us claim to follow Jesus, we are failing miserably at listening. We would rather assert ourselves in order to climb the corporate ladder and prove our significance than answer the questions that are written on the faces and in the hearts of those we lead. Theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer said it so well. The first service one owes to others in the community involves listening to them. Just as our love for God begins with listening to God's Word, the beginning of love for other Christians is learning to listen to them. God's love for us is shown by the fact that God not only gives us God's Word, but also lends us God's ear. I think many of us have forgotten that this is our first and primary responsibility as leaders. Recently, while traveling in Australia, I, Steve, was craving a spiritual conversation with a stranger. It happened in a taxi cruising along the shoreline of downtown Sydney. The taxi driver had grown up in Somalia and migrated with his family to Australia. We had a great chat about his faith and what he thought about God and Jesus. As we neared the airport, I offered to pray for him and then asked him one last question. "What advice do you have for me as I relate to Muslims around the world?" His answer didn't surprise me, but it did disappoint me. He replied, "Christians don't listen. They don't even try to understand us. They just tell us what to think." Ouch, that hurt. I believe that Omar was overgeneralizing, but I'm grieved that he has that perception of Jesus' followers. I wonder how many others share his view. Wouldn't it be extraordinary if the followers of Jesus were widely known and respected for being people who asked good questions and genuinely concentrated on understanding others? Wouldn't it be helpful if we were known for listening rather than telling? Understanding rather than demanding to be understood? So where are we going with all this? We want to help you become a more successful leader who has a more loyal team. We want to see your influence grow and your organization thrive. We want your team to feel heard and valued so they feel inspired to reach their fullest potential. All of that can only happen as you intentionally work on your listening skills. But, you might be wondering, does listening mean I'm going to agree with everyone on everything? Or that I'm going to be able to get everyone to agree with me? No. Before we go any further, let's just clarify what we're not saying, and then we'll get to what we are promising. What we're not saying. Listening means agreeing, not true. As a leader, you will seek to listen to make the other person feel heard and understood. That does not necessarily mean you'll acquiesce to them or that they will agree with you. Each person has the right to their own opinions. Listening means you'll wait to make decisions until everyone is on the same page. Not true. As leaders, we believe in consensus building. However, it is unrealistic that everyone will agree. There are some decisions that have to be made even when others are not in agreement. Listening means everyone will love you and you won't get criticized. Not true. Jesus was a phenomenal listener, but not everyone loved him. He certainly had his share of critics. The same will be true for you. More people will like you if you listen, but don't count on everyone liking you. Our promise to you. We can promise you that if you practice the skills outlined in this book, you will become more influential and trustworthy as a leader. Your organization will experience more success as people feel valued and heard. You'll create a culture of collaboration and cooperation. Team members will be more engaged and feel more empowered. Does that sound good to you? If you're an emerging leader and want to grow your leadership skills, the principles in this book will help you. You'll have to decide to commit to working on these skills, and we must warn you, they don't come naturally. But the results will be worth the effort. Throughout the rest of this book, we're going to examine how to listen so that you can become more self-aware and less self-absorbed. Know and understand your people. Give the gifts of trust and empowerment. Invite others to help shape the vision. Discern unspoken values. Look for truth in criticism. Engage conflict constructively. Listen to collect stories and build brand evangelists. Create sacred space for personal reflection and listening to God. Our promise is that as you learn to tune your ear to wisdom and concentrate on understanding, Proverbs chapter 2, verse 2, your leadership and your team will be transformed. While many of the examples we share throughout the book are about high-level leaders, the lessons are for anyone who has influence or who wants to increase their impact. This could include young professionals who are looking to grow their leadership skills, coaches, teachers, leaders in neighborhood associations, or leaders of the PTA, for example. The bottom line is that if you want to increase your influence, you must first learn to listen. If you learn to make people feel heard and valued, people will want to follow you. Team loyalty will soar. How can we claim this? Because we've seen it happen. Not just in our ministry, but in the many companies and ministries we've worked with. When you prioritize your listening ear and tune in to what others need, you'll find that the respect others have for you will grow and the breadth of your influence will expand. It may not always come quickly or in ways you expect, but it will come. So what can you expect from this book? What you can expect. Each chapter will include teaching points, stories, and keys to enhance your listening skills as a leader. In addition, at the end of each chapter, you'll notice two categories of questions. Questions to ask your team and Questions for Self-Leadership. We encourage you not to skip these sections. As you practice asking your team questions and give them permission to be honest, trust in your leadership will grow. As you reflect and answer the self-leadership questions, you'll become more aware of both your strengths and weaknesses regarding your listening. These questions are designed to help you analyze where you'd like to grow as a leader, both in terms of listening to your team and understanding yourself. Here's your first set of questions. Questions to ask your team. Preface these questions by explaining to your team that you want to work on your listening skills, so you'd like to ask them a few questions. Invite them to be honest and assure them that there is safety in their honesty. 1. What's one area of my listening that you'd like to see change? 2. On a scale of 1 to 10, with 1 being almost never to 10 being often, how often do I interrupt you or other team members? 3. Do you feel like you have adequate time with me to process your thoughts and concerns? 4. Do you feel safe to share new ideas, or do you feel as though new ideas are met with pushback? 5. When I'm in a meeting, does it seem as though I am fully present or distracted? 6. Describe for me a time when you felt I was being defensive. How did that make you feel? Questions for self-leadership. 1. How would you describe yourself as a leader? Are you more of a consensus builder or an autocrat? 2. Do you consider yourself more of an extrovert or an introvert? How does that impact the way you listen? 3. Is it difficult for you to be patient when someone is talking? Do you find yourself hurrying them up by trying to complete their sentences? 4. What has to change in the culture of your team or organization for people to feel safe enough to share their opinions? 5. What do you like best about your personal leadership style? As we move ahead, you'll want to take inventory of your growth. You'll need to be intentional for your listening skills to develop. You'll also need to shift your focus from all the clutter in your mind to the thoughts and feelings of others. For many leaders, that can be a challenge, but it's a skill well worth the effort. As we said earlier in this chapter, Jesus was highly focused on the needs of others. Any sense of self-preservation or advancement was set aside for the sake of others. We're convinced that God wants to see your impact grow and your leadership flourish. Ready to begin? Read on. 2. Become self-aware, not self-obsessed. But who can discern their own errors? Psalm 19, verse 12. Key: great leaders pay attention to how they're coming across. While attending a conference for leaders and speakers, we heard this startling statement: the higher a person rises in leadership, the less self-aware they often become. Wow, scary thought. We can't verify if that's true because the statement wasn't backed up with statistics. However, the authors of Strengths-Based Leadership, Tom Rath and Barry Conchie, write, "All too often, leaders are blind to the obvious when it comes to something of critical importance to them, their own personality. Many political and business leaders have self-concepts that are miles away from reality." As we thought about that statement, our minds traveled back to the beginning of our ministry life together. As I, Steve, mentioned earlier, our first church was in a rural farming community. We were located next to a chicken farm. Of course, there was no air conditioning in our ancient building. On hot summer days, we opened the fragile stained glass windows to get some air into the sanctuary. Within minutes, the odor of fresh chicken poop invaded every nook and cranny of the building. We didn't have a lot of sophisticated people in our church. The pews were too hard, and the smell was too bad. Our church was for humble folk. We had a bunch of farmers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.